Simon & Schuster Audio presents Notes from the Henhouse on Marrying a Poet, Raising Children and Chickens, and Writing by Elspeth Barker. Read by Raffaella Barker, with a prologue written and read by Raffaella Barker.
There is no reciprocity. Men love women. Women love children. Children love hamsters. Alice Thomas Ellis. For my siblings, Ruddy, Progles, Sam and Lily, remembering all the ways our darling mum taught us how to love. Prologue. Life's Motorway by Raffaella Barker. We have a family photograph taken in the shed where the tractors lived during my childhood and where, eventually, my father's mouldering Mercedes, a skeleton of a canoe and a Sinclair C5 car would all be laid to rest. The photograph was taken in the early 1970s, on a rainy day, when a journalist and a photographer from the Sunday Times came to see my father, the poet, and his family. We all assembled in the broken-down cart shed, the kind of place photographers favour. My father, George, his waterproof jacket zipped, holds my hand, grinning out into the dripping October day. I hide inside my new hooded school coat, shy at 7. My brothers, one defiant in his cowboy hat, the other with a baseball cap askew over his ear, are in front of us. My mother Elspeth stands forward, rain beads in her hair, marshalling our donkeys, who had wandered in to see what the fuss was about. Elspeth's gaze sparkles, her beauty radiates, wellies muddy, Macintosh buttoned, hands lost in the manes of the donkeys. She is as poised and self-possessed as if she were being photographed in Cecil Beaton's studio, and her presence is arresting. We are grouped like a family of statues, yet the drip of rain through the leaking roof, the animal's implacable disapproval, and the escape we three children are itching to get on with, are palpable as we face the lens, our expressions lit with electricity of connection to one another. A family. And then, behind my father, something seems to move in the captured stillness of the photograph. Out of the darkness, a face appears. A profile. Light glancing off cheekbone. Eyes down. A brow carved. Nose aquiline. The mouth curved beneath in symmetrical beauty. Who can it be? How can it be? No one else was there that day. No one can make sense of it. Not now, not ever in the many years the picture hung in the kitchen of my mother's house. The photographer was interrogated, the barn was investigated, nothing. A ghost? An angel? Why not? No other explanation seemed possible. And faced with the evidence, it was reasonable. In our world, anyway. Sorting out my mother's papers after her death, I came across the photograph again. Its mystery still unsolved. No answers likely, as counting the ghost, three of its subjects were now dead. And then, while reading my mother's essays for this collection, I found her words. The ancient Greeks had a notion that the image lay waiting to be discovered and released. So it seems to me that images deliberately lurk about in the effluvium of our lives until such time as we recognise them. They have always been there, waiting for this moment. Her musings on the significance of an image are as real and apposite to the moment as if she were talking directly to me. This is the case with so much of what she writes. Every story flies through the years to land in the moment it seems it was made for. And that perhaps is the hallmark of great writing. It also makes sense of the angel. This book, created from an excavation of Elspeth's essays and short stories, also seems to have flown through the years to land here and now. The pieces we have brought to light were originally published some years ago, the essays alongside her journalism in a volume, Dog Days, and the short stories accompanying a 2010 reissue of O Caledonia. Working with a small publishing house, Black Dog Books, my mother had, with some diffidence, put together fragments and thoughts that marked the elements of life that compelled her imagination and her art. Reading them now, when it is no longer possible to talk to her, I am struck by both the immediacy of her voice and the enduring romance of her spirit. Some of the essays are straightforward autobiography, others are written as short stories, but the material explored comes from her own experience, and, as such, lands vivid and alive in the reader's mind. If O Caledonia was a version of Elspeth's childhood in her own words, it made sense to find a way for her to continue to tell her story. For me to weave the essays and stories into a loose chronology, leaving a handful of pieces to make up an appendix, was an experience as close as mortality allows to talking with my mother about her life and the things she loved. The result of putting the selection together has given voice to Elspeth again, and perhaps it serves to illuminate her spirit too, and the singular vision she had of the world she lived in. There are thoughts on raising children, being married, being widowed, cooking supper, hens, snowdrops, rivers and floods, sunsets, death and daydreams, unreliable cars, and the incredible passion that words can muster. It's all there, spooled through the faultless sentences she wrote and also spoke in, the humour of which catches a reader unaware and warms the heart long after the pages are closed, the book put away. My mother loved her life, and as her family, in this first year of grief, knowing that is comforting. Her telling us how she saw it is a gift. No one can really know what their life means to other people, and my mother was unassuming, although her own love of literature showed her the value of reading past writers. Her ability to look both backwards and forwards, and to form thoughts about how and why the ordinary matters, brings us a rich legacy. As was said in one of her obituaries in April 2022, she was never, ever dull. In one essay within this collection, Elspeth referred to the steering of one's vehicle along life's motorway. Elspeth's own journey along life's motorway began in Scotland, in an echoing Scottish castle, where she tamed a jackdaw and often saw the ghost of her grandmother waving from a turret. Her Highland childhood and her time at boarding school in St Andrews are transformed into myth in her only novel, O Caledonia, where the misunderstood heroine is murdered on the first page. Even this dramatic fictional event has roots in Elspeth's own real-life preferences. I remember my mother saying whilst writing this book, "The thing is, I can't stand the name Janet, so the only possibility for this person, now I've got her, is to murder her." From school, Elspeth's next motorway stop was Oxford, where she assumed an attitude of bohemian glamour and did very little work. She was 17, and having read a lot of poetry and espoused various causes, she quickly adopted a style: pale skin, black eyeliner, wild black hair and dramatic clothing, often purple silk or black. This wardrobe would remain with her throughout her life, whether attending events in a muddy pig field in Norfolk or an infamous pub in Soho. Leaving university, Elspeth moved to London and worked part-time in Foyle's bookshop and as a waitress in a Lion's Corner House coffee shop. She was remembered by a university friend as extraordinarily attractive to men, and her own stories of this time include numerous fiancés, as well as a man who said he'd married her by proxy and would be taking her back to his home in Nigeria. She avoided this plan by cleverly climbing out of the window at the back of her flat, while her besotted admirer waited at the front door. Instead, she fell in love with George Barker, famous poet and womaniser, whom she had met through his former partner, Elizabeth Smart. Elizabeth, whose novel By Grand Central Station I Sat Down and Wept was written about her relationship with George, was to become a friend of Elspeth's. But back in the beginning, Elizabeth warned my mother against him. She didn't heed the warning, though. She was taking one of life's leaps of faith, and throwing caution and her upbringing to the wind, she followed her heart with George. George and Elspeth moved to Norfolk in the late 1960s, and the ramshackle farmhouse they lived in turned out to be her longest stop on life's motorway. Much of that time glimmers in the essays we find in this collection. Life in Norfolk was full and demanding. There was no money, a lot of animals, and five children. She and my father had had a tempestuous relationship. Despite the well-documented setback that he had never been divorced from his first wife, Jessica, and had children with two other women before he and my mother met, they were together until the last.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.